So, lovely day. We're starting with security. Why? All about payments and talk about security. Well, the aim of this presentation is to give you an idea about why are we talking about security and what are the things that we should be doing and we should not be doing while running a payment company. So we don't go through some of the bad phases that some of the companies have gone through. Okay, I'm Shadab. I'll be taking a couple of next few minutes to give you guys an insights about security in payments and the common pitfalls. So the first question is, why security? I'll just ignore it. Okay. Something is like, what's the general idea about security in payments? Okay. If I would say, it would be like, if we have all of these things in place, we are sort of secure. This is what, like, I'll say most of the payment companies aim for. We get these things on our website and app and we're good to go, right? But are we, should we? So the best example I could give you of was Equifax. I guess you guys know about it. Well, everything was good. It was running for more than a decade and someone exploited some vulnerability and then they figured out the way they were storing passwords were MD5. Now, security by obscurity, never. Okay? Having compliance is good, which means this, but that doesn't make you secure. Okay, I'll just play a small video to kick off and then we'll see. So, it's not clear, but you will see a few things. Okay? Now, what we see in this video is, like, we see, like, few of you would be amused, few of you would found it funny, few would be like, it's a bit awkward, and if I would have played along for a long time, the security folks would be like, are you serious? This is not how things work. And I know that. Okay? That's the same questions security folks have when we see payment app. Okay? You have all those things, all those signs that I showed you, with 256-bit encryption, military-grade security, all those things in place. But when we actually dig in deep, what we find is you do not have authorizations on your APIs. Like, as simple as that. Anyone can bypass your login system as well. Okay? So, be sure of how you do things. So, why are we talking about security? Security is something that everyone has a point of view. Okay? Or let me give you an anecdote where if I stay, tell Zainab on how to run a Hasgeek conference where, okay, you know what, I found one problem and I think you should fix this better. Now, as a human psychology, we tend to come up with patterns. So, we have a point of view with one problem that we have figured out. So, the problem with security is everyone has faced some kind of a thing and everyone has an idea about security. But are they actually the experts to make a comment on that? Like, those feedback could be valuable. But is it actually that much important or the main point of all of the things? Okay. So, couple of facts. Where this is from IBM report 2007. Where it says the cost of a breach is $3.62 million. Okay. And 88% of the attacks that happen are actually something that were figured out in 2014. Okay? These are a couple of facts and figures that will help you understand why are we starting the session with security. Okay? 43% of cyber attacks are actually on small business, which will be a bit of shocker because we assume, hey, we are small. Like, most of the payment companies think we are small. We don't have that much big of a customer base. Why would someone be attacking us? is something that you have to look out for. On an average, it takes 197 days to detect a breach. Actually, it's actually more than that. But do you think you have things in place to figure that out? Talking about cost, it's $6 trillion by 2021. I have the sources for all of these in the end of the slides. You guys can go through it. Human attack surface area is increasing like anything. Now, just on this point, US spent $28 billion in cybersecurity in 2016, which would be like combining a couple of unicorn companies of India, valuation, but they're more than their valuation they spent in 2016 alone. Okay, and where we have tons of payment companies here, how much have we spent or invested, I'll say. Couple of other facts were like 1 in 31 email contains malware, all of this. Now, the point is, if the attack surface is this big, how much have you taken care of? Okay, are you sure you can, like, if there are like 2,30,000 malware getting developed every day, are you sure that your system are secure enough? Do you have everything in place to figure that out? So, the reason I call this mother of all fallacies in security is, this is one thing security completely revolves around, okay? Which is breaking all assumptions. So, just to give you an anecdote here from one of my colleagues from earlier, let's say there's a statement. Tom bought a book for rupees 100. How many of you could say how many assumptions are there in this statement? How many of you would say 3 assumptions are there? Are there any assumptions? Raise your hand. Yes, no. How many? 3? 4? Anyone else? Out of a sentence made up of 6 words, there are 5 assumptions. Let's say it was an e-commerce website. And my data says, like, let's say I'm the owner of that e-commerce website. My data says, Tom bought a book for rupees 100. The first assumption is the guy who's actually buying book is Tom. Then he is buying. Okay, because my database says he's buying. Then he bought a book. Then he bought book. Then he bought it for rupees 100. Just because I have a database entry of saying someone did this, doesn't actually make, like, how does this happen is something I'll cover in the next couple of slides. Okay, just an image that can explain you, there's a complete door with a sliding door and a hole just to slide the door, and there's a complete bypass of it, right? Couple of security phases that we'll be covering. This isn't the complete list, but this is something that I'll be touching upon for this presentation. Compliance. What is actually compliance? Is the first question that we need to ask. Okay. Compliance means that if some company is certified, that the process they are following to get compliant, that all the process that they're doing is all good, and it doesn't certify the end product is good enough or not. For example, PCIDSS. PCIDSS means that the process that a company is following is all good, but it never guarantees that the company is secure. Okay? And there are tons of examples of that. So, compliance is a part of security, not security. You should be running for compliance, obviously. If there is no business, there's no point of security. But if there is no security, your business won't run for long. Compliance is all about a bit of policies, standard rules, and a strategy. If something goes wrong, what and how would you go about it? Okay, yes. So let me ask you one question. How many of you have phones which are which came in post September 2017? Almost all of you? No? Which were released post September 2017? So, why don't we do that with security? Again, I'll talk about Equifax, where I was compliant enough, being Equifax, I was compliant enough for way too long. I was handling all the PII data, everything, credit card numbers, and I was storing cards in MD5. Is that right? Just because no one can figure out, does that mean I can do whatever I want? Or is compliance making you secure? Something that you have to think. Application security integration. This is one big topic. The first statement that I'll make, I'm not discussing about OS top 10. I'll assume that's the baseline that everyone would have, because we can go on days talking about OS top 10. It's not going to end. Okay, so that is something I'm taking as a baseline. What I'll be talking about here is, with all my experience for the last 7-8+ years, I've seen tons of big companies and banks that have fallen victim to these, and their companies are still falling victim to these kind of small goof-ups, which I'm demonstrating. Hashes. So here the first one that I have is algorithm. So the thing I'll start with is about like 5 years back, where there, 5 to 6 years back, where there were not very too many payment companies big enough. Okay, and one of the big payment in, companies that I was testing had, which was there for more than 2 decades, had a hash in place for all the integrity check. The problem with that was the algorithm they were using was Adler 32, which is way too weak. Okay, no, it's just a stream, like it's a 32-bit thing, and it's way too weak. I can discuss about the details. Now the problem with that was I could actually buy everything for free, though they had integrity check in place. Okay. Now the other problem that comes is, now sometimes I see that payment company is actually using a good enough salted integrity hash checksum, but what they lack is that they don't include all the parameters in place, like the transaction ID or the merchant name. So what happens now, for any transaction ID, I can actually use the same checksum that they had, just because, for the same amount obviously, like there are certain prerequisites, but they don't include all of those things. The third part I'm saying is validation. Now I've seen companies, like this is one of the most common, where they are using the right algorithm, they have all the parameters validation, but they are not validating the checksum. I know it sounds like, hey, that's like basic 101, but that's what I'm saying, that's what's missing right now. Like, I have tested tons of companies, I'm telling you, this is what is missing right now. Just to give you an example with two images, is like, I'll give you guys a second to see the first and the second image. Like, a guy has invested enough to keep a security guard to do a check. And that's what happened. And this happens, I'm telling you, with tons of, like the latest 2016-17 companies as well. You have everything, he's checking it, but there's no point of having him there. Okay? Payment secrets and salts. Okay? Here is something that I want to talk about is, all the companies that I know of, almost, the way they share secret is either it's available on a portal, or they, actually, many companies, they send it across to the guy they're interacting with, the merchant. Now, it's the salt. If I know, so obviously me being a product guy will forward to an engineer, then someone would integrate. Now, the salt has been thrown out to so many people that all of those can actually go ahead and do free transactions. And there is no way to trace it back. What's missing right now is, we have to come up with the smart ways on how the salt sharing should happen between the payment gateway and the merchants, which is there not in a very good fashion. Okay. The other problem is when a salt gets compromised, then a lot of companies again do not support 2+ salts. Okay. They say, okay, you could go ahead and change it from salt 1 to salt 2, but the problem is, there are valid use cases where we have to support 2 salts, and that's not there. The problem with that is either the merchant loses customer or there's a compromise on
there is a monetary compromise that happens. Talking about transaction logic, wallet security. Any product folks here? Awesome. Wallet security. So you guys obviously want that, hey, ideally the payment should be without any friction. Correct? Like guy should come to product and the moment he thinks and there should be payment done. Okay? That's where the wallet came in because India has 2FA in place. Now the problem with wallet security is, and almost all the wallet companies have P2P in place. The moment I log in, I can do a transaction. Okay, think about this. My account is compromised. Someone logs in, transfer all my P2P to someplace else. Now the problem is, what kind of securities do we have in place? Just that, okay, you are responsible for the account security of your account. Apart from that, do we have any kind of fingerprint in place? I'm not talking about that naive fingerprint, okay, five items that you figured out. Can you actually determine a legitimate guy versus a non-legitimate guy? Because more ease, see, usability and security go hand in hand. The more user experience, the less is security. The more security, the better an experience. Correct? So this is something that I'll say you guys have to figure out in terms of what's the kind of security do we have in our wallet system that will make sure that our legitimate users don't get compromised and we can track the illegitimate ones. Gift card security. Here, almost like I'm talking about 2 years back, all websites, all the companies were broken in certain fashion or the other. Okay. The way they were generating, the pin they had, like the same goes for coupon abuse as well. The way they were generating, the pin they had, all could have been brute force, misuse, and you wouldn't know about it. I'm saying the aim here is to see, have you thought it through? And I'm telling you about a company few days back which had very bad logic of generating goof-ups. Okay, it's not something of real past I'm talking about, it's something that happens. See, it could be like, okay, you are the lead, you know how to do it. But the moment you delegate it to someone else to do, does he has the right capability to do it or not? He could be a fresher, or you could bank on him, or he could think, who would know or figure this out that I'm just changing the last digit, right? Then UPI. So I'll just talk about one example of UPI is when someone initiate and says, hey, a push notification comes to app. The point is, then there is no hash in place, okay, from UPI itself, okay. Now the point is, people can change from 100 rupees to one, though they are paying for one, but there is no validation of what's happening. Okay, those are a couple of things that I wanted to talk about in application security. Integration, so maybe you have awesome security in place, but integration is not equal to your security. Integration, I can't tell you how many times I have seen broken just because not two parties are involved. It's just not you. You are security savvy enough, but the other party is not. They are not validating. Then you have refund APIs, you have tons of other things in place. So you have to make sure at the end how the integration is happening. Okay? Network, infra, cloud. This is another big one where we assume we move, all of us have moved, not all of us, but mostly all of us have moved from typical DC to cloud, and we assume now cloud would take care of everything in place. Just giving an example of AWS, it's clearly mentioned on the website, security is 50% shared responsibility between the person using it and AWS itself. Okay? Now, the problem there is, how do you go about saying, okay, I have security in cloud, in cloud, what all things you have to take care of and what all things do I don't? As simple as all other systems that are there, let's say maybe your systems are good enough, but like just talking about Dirty Cow, which was a Linux privilege escalation vulnerability, The point is, someone at the end, it's one place where all the things are there. Now, how you have configured is something that I could, exploiting someone else, can get into your system. A classic example would be 4 years back, an Indian company got hacked where someone exploited shell shock vulnerability, got into their servers, which was running for more than 4 years old, okay, and sent a email to all the customers that we are shutting down. Okay, now whose responsibility is this? Like, shell shock was patched, but they had a box which was running for more than 4 years. And it was just a part of fraud VPC. That was the only problem. Security issue due to misconfiguration. RMQ is just one, rabbit messaging queue is just one example. Here, I can't tell you how many screw-ups. I guess Akash would be talking about all those things in place. Where, like, the reason example I put RMQ is there. I have seen businesses that actually completely work on, like, that messaging queue has their business logic. Now, the business logic, such critical data, and they have no authentication in place. And the administrator account for, login account for RMQ is guess, which is publicly available and anyone can access it. So the point is, when you see the data, you see, okay, the whole business depend on this. I consume it, they wouldn't know about it. And it's all gone. Okay, so RMQ is just one example. There are tons of things you have to take care on. How do you fix it? I have seen databases which are publicly available and have no authentication in place. Fraud databases. Okay. So the reason I have the third point here is I was talking to a couple of senior security, not security, DevOps guys. And they said, hey, after, I'll just give example of Amazon, because after Amazon started patching in December, Spectre and this, almost all the systems, their CPU latency went high. Now people are saying, for every CPU latency that's going high, they're saying it's because Amazon is doing it. And one was actually getting attacked. Now, again, it's an assumption that because I have seen like three systems, Amazon is patching, latency goes up, my resource utilization goes up. One guy didn't realize that someone was actually exploiting his system. Okay, so cloud security is all about, think about this. These two bugs in itself, no one knew for two decades. Everyone was good. Okay, the problem with cloud security is not just cloud, the security is the ROI, or you don't know, you cannot quantify how good it is. If Intel would have patched like two decades back, like, how big is this? 20 years later, we know the impact. We can quantify it now, not like 20 years back, right? Patch updates, like, again, couple of months back where Node.js says all their versions are vulnerable to DOS. And they are releasing a patch, and there was like a time of 15-20 days where there was no patch. How do you go about it? How of you actually knew about it? How many of you actually did something about it? Okay, not just patching the system that are running, but let's say your whole application is hosted on Node.js and every version is vulnerable to DOS. How do you go about it? It's something we need to think very hard. IAM for all devices, the reason I'm talking IAM for all devices, IAM means identity and access management, is we have inventory in place, like the other example that I was giving where a company was hacked just because they had a system running for, a machine running, EC2 machine running for 4 years, is because when you're small, you have five people, you know everything. And there's a time, the moment you become 200 or 100. The point is, now all the things that I was doing has been delegated to this guy. Okay? Or I'll give you a real example where we figured out a small company, one of the DevOps was running a gaming server in the prod server, a counter side gaming server in the prod box. And no one had idea about it. And this could be happening to any one of us. How do you keep a track of it? Or now anyone can be using it for mining as well. because they are the folks that are doing that. Okay. DDoS protection, again, more than three decades old thing, it still exists. Just moving to cloud doesn't help you. A small scale of DDoS, they say they can handle, but for others, you have to handle. Okay. Now, the DDoS is just not now sync attack itself. Now, you have APIs all around. I've seen companies just, they are down because someone is abusing one APIs of theirs. Okay. How you architect your system is again important. Okay. Just think about this, one API bringing your whole system down. Okay, I just can't name companies for the naming and shaming, but because I interact with a lot of CTOs, I am telling you, things actually go like weird when these kind of things happen. And you scratch your head because while starting, you didn't care about it. It's just a small company, who cares? Look, you care, but not that much. And then when you hit, it's the security is not the most important thing. Log analysis and correlation. Here it's actually important. Again, this is just not a simple SOC what I'm talking about. It's actually far more than that. So you need to have a small engineering team to correlate all the logs that you have. So I'll give you one example of Ola. This is just one instance of Ola I'm talking about. Where, think about this, drivers are getting really smart. Okay. Fraud could be any level, okay? Now, let's say our customer, partner, customer care calls are increasing that for certain cases, okay? And we see jump in one API. Now, we know drivers are abusing certain thing in a certain manner, just if you can correlate these two things. This is one very naive example that I'm giving. You guys have far more valuable use cases. Now, if you can keep a track of what's happening, like if you could connect these systems, I'm telling you all the frauds, actually you can detect in real time. It's just that we need to put in effort to figure that out, which is actually missing from all of us. This is just one example. Like I was talking to one of the guys, like CDO, and they said, hey, we are set up. So, they hosted a Git. It was publicly available, protected by username, password, which was integrated with their LDAP. So obviously no one can access, though it was publicly available. A small misconfiguration issue was this. Now, the point is, by default, when you set up a local Git, you can sign in with Google @Gmail as well. With this, I actually logged in into his, company's official Git repo. And I could see all the code. And there wasn't a log of it. Like, think about this. You think, hey, everything is protected. Just one small problem, your whole code is gone. And you can't figure that out. I log in, I copy paste the whole code. You can't figure that out. And it's like the image explained in itself. You think, hey, there's just one small. What are the odds of someone getting through it in one shot? Correct? And I'm saying, like, the odds are way too high than you think. Just because you're on this side of the table, doesn't mean someone on that side of the table is not smart enough. So, cloud security is all about reducing the attack surface area, where this much is the attack surface area, you reduce it to this much, that only very smart guys could get through. Earlier, 1,000 guys could get through, now only one. But there is always a possibility that someone would get through, and probably in one shot. Okay? Couple of goof-ups that happens, this and the next one are big ones where I have tons of data on the slides, but I didn't wanted to miss out any of those. GitHub. I'll explain this just by another major unicorn company got hacked two months back, where one guy, because this was a way too big organization, one guy committed some credentials in public GitHub. And I, as an attacker, went and exploited the system. Right? It sounds funny, but think about this. When you have 2,000 plus guys with you, you cannot keep a track of it. What happened to them can happen to anybody. And it's not a breach in some fashion, but it's a breach in some fashion. Okay. Now, how do you make sure that your guys... So, again, I'll give you one more example of... I'll skip that. But how about this? Where, like, I wrote some awesome automation. I committed that code to GitHub. Obviously, you need to show your awesome coding skills on GitHub. Now, the only part that, because it had tons of code in it, the only part that was missing was it had my, let's say, corporate account, password and username, and the whole thing works on SSO. How about that? Now, my account gets compromised for every place. Okay? So, the aim here is you need to have system in place, being payment, that if one of you guys by mistake commit codes to GitHub, you should be notified in real time. GitHub is just one example. It could be any place like Pastebin, Pasty, any place. Okay, because people copy paste the code outside asking a couple of questions. What happens that? And that's your logic of doing something really important. Now you don't know. Everyone knows that this is how you generate coupons. I'm just giving an example. Okay. Third party dependency. Again, how many of you can say right now, you can name all the third party dependencies in your company? From Kafka, Sentry, to everything, Log4j, everything. How many projects are being used? What all things that are being used? Can any of one of you can say the whole inventory of third party projects? No. Okay. I'm saying that's what happened with Equifax. Like, can you say like you're using Apache Struts in couple of projects? But can you name right now how many projects are using Apache Struts? No. And when someone exploits it, then you come to know. What I'm saying is you guys need to have a list of all third party dependencies. Which of them are vulnerable, which of them not, is something that you need to have. Okay. At Ola, we do maintain all of these things, okay, to figure out, okay, which are vulnerable, how exactly we are using it, how exactly we are not, what could go wrong, are there vulnerable components that we are using or we are not. Okay, something that I'll say for payments, it's actually must. OTPs, man, this one is a big one. I can't tell you, like, how many different kind of OTP bypass I have found in my life. One. Second, I have seen code which says 1000 plus random 3. Okay, now I have seen so much code which is, I just call them blacksmith code, in terms of ki I label as like, hey, my payment company has military grade security, and like it's a blacksmith code that's happening behind. Like 1000 plus this, or just changing one character. Now, that's not how you validate OTP or generate OTP. Okay, even though you could say, hey, sign up on my website happens via OTP validation. Like, that's fair. But have you been sure that there is no bypass to that? Okay, I have seen issues where, just going a bit technical, where people put the OTPs in Zedish and the Zedish cache gets cleared and then there is no validation happening. I'm saying, understand, at the end of the day, it's a guy who's writing code with certain mindset and certain assumptions on how it's going to be used, okay, whether that code is running in an airplane or in a payment system. Okay, and because I have written that code with certain assumptions, there's always a possibility to be bypassed. Okay, that's all I'll say. How you generate OTP is really important, and how you validate is very important. Like I'm saying, Zedish cache, I'm telling you, it gets cleared, or you spawn a new cluster, there are no things, and you are validating it. At the end, just a code bug. Okay, vendors. Here, what I mean is, obviously, we have to use tons of vendors to send OTPs, transactional OTPs, login OTPs, and tons of other things to the customers. How exactly is your contract with them? What happens if they get breached? Because you say, for this phone number, the OTP is this. Okay? I'll talk about just biggest goof up. Like, it was one of the biggest bank in India right now. I'm telling you like 3 years old story. where when you go to that 2FA page of the bank, you say, I want to pay by credit card, okay? You go to that 2FA page, the 3D secure pin. So that bank, the way it was doing, so after you put in your thing, they used to generate a small checksum, which was like a 8-digit code, not a checksum, I'll say. Okay, that was just authorizing that transaction. Now the fun part was, every time I do a transaction, if I return that code, the transaction was successful. This is, I'm talking about one of the biggest banks in India. Like, at the end, as I said, like, it's one guy writing a piece of code with certain assumptions in mind. Again, it's okay to store passwords, email, GPS location of the customers. You want to give them a better user experience, I understand. Now, how and where do you store it is these two points cover. It's okay to hold on to that information, not on the device and not in plain text format. Understand. Device is something that you do not own. Okay. There are tons of thousand things on the app. I've seen customers getting exploited just because some company was storing some other information. Okay. I'll give you an example. Password. And there was a malware in the phone which was taking that password and trying on all different websites. And that guy had same password across. Pre-auth. This is so important, I can't tell you, where all of you from payments companies know how many fraud requests you get in a day, where people have added 11, 15, 20 debit cards to one account, then one debit card to 20,000 accounts. Okay, those are all frauds. You figure out when a cybercrime complaint comes to you. Do you know right now? How can you fix it? For better user, product guys, for better user experience, we don't add pre-auth. Let him add and then we'll see whenever he wants to transact. But can we take a step back and think, can we mandate pre-auth for adding all the cards? Because I can't tell companies, but I've seen finance guys, the head of finance getting spoofed into sharing his credit card details to someone and then getting breached. Okay. I'm not sure how many of you support multi-currency. This is one funny way I've seen, let's say on my credit card for US, I have $100 negative balance. What I do, just because they don't have validation check on the currency, I change it to INR. I actually pay 100 INR and in that thing, and that currency is not a part of the checksum. So I change it back to USD. Now, just paying 100 rupees, I clear my debt of $100. This happens. How do you handle multi-currency is something that you have to look. And there are tons of cases around that. Refund API. I can't tell you how much abuse I have seen of refund API from so many folks. Refund API just means that obviously when you integrate with merchants, they run something, and at the end what happens is because of the bank failed transaction or net banking takes up to 4-5 days of transactions, you have to refund, not refund, whatever needs to happen. The way all the companies generally implement, I'm not generalizing the statement, I'm saying mostly implement, is they have just an API key. You are a merchant, I give you merchant key 1. That's the security of a refund API, which actually credits money to a customer's account. Some of you folks have gone a bit deep, but again, I can talk about all of that, but I'm saying it's not secure. Refund API, you don't know how much abuse is being happening just because you don't have the metrics and not collecting the data. Just as good as third-party libraries that I talked about, right? Until you get exploited of it, you're like, it's all good. I'm saying it's not. Cron. Okay. It's linked to the refund API itself. Payment systems obviously have a lot of crons to do daily analysis and then send the rest of the money here to the company's bank account or this, do all the validation. Now, cron obviously means it has the power to send money, push money, tons of things in place. Okay? How many people in your organization have access to that cron? That means, obviously, there would be some API key, some access token, some place. If I, as a dev, product guy, DevOps, knows about it and I start misusing it, what happens? Do you guys even know about it? These are big goof-ups that no one is looking at, is something that I'm trying to cover. Success URL, failure URL, replay attacks. So this goes back to my hash validation part, where when from payment gateway merchant, if you're coming back to merchant, merchant obviously defines for failure URL go here, success URL go here. Just because you don't include success or the failure URL in in your validation, hash validation, you can screw up big time. Big time means big time. Leakage of sensitive information, something all good. I'll run through just because I have still a lot of to cover. Goof-up operationally is, let me talk about a couple of important things in terms of data security. Here is, we at the end trust that our customer, our employees won't misuse our data. I'm not like pointing a finger there, but I'm saying at the end, when you grow big, you'll have tons of employees who would have access to a lot of customer data. If you don't plan to have data security from starting, you're going to be screwed up big time, is what I'm saying, because you have all the salts of all the merchants and everyone has access to all of it. Just a reality check is something that you have to see is what is stored, how it is stored, where is it stored, who have access to that kind of a data. I'm just running through, there's something important I'll discuss in detail. How are they stored and what kind of people have access to that? And have you classified the data from starting? So right now, I understand when you're small, it's like, what's the need? Like it's just 10 folks and we know this is critical, this is confidential, this is okay. But tomorrow you won't be 10 people. And they won't understand your definition of critical, confidential, non-confidential. Okay? Why is security hard? There is no way to quantify what you're doing. Security is like medical insurance. You pay premium for the next 10 years, nothing happens to you, like, dude, all the money gone bad. You pay premium for a year, something happens, and that money comes in use, you're like, see, I paid 1 year premium, or I had the medical insurance just for this. So it's hard to quantify what you're doing is adding value or not. Then it actually doesn't add something to your business growth and deliverables in terms of, again, numbers. This is one important one because where we have a couple of devs who are security savvy. Okay, the problem with that is they think, hey, SQL injections, no worry, we'll use prepared statements. Now, just give an example, active records, which is prepared statements in Ruby, could also have SQL injections, because you are doing a concatenation at the end. Just an example. So assuming that, hey, I'm good enough, I don't need security team, probably wrong. Do not improve security. You have to create application infra which is secure. Don't think, let me build on it, I'll add security later. Security is not like you will build a fortress around it. No. It's not going to work that way. I'll skip this example. Latency versus security is something I'll cover. Again, very big vendor in payments in India. They support latency up to 60 seconds. So what happens is, if you start a transaction with them, while they are doing a transaction, you could actually do all the money as P2P. Okay. And that transaction was still successful. This is, I'm telling you, like 4 years back. Okay. Now, I could actually do anything on that payment vendor for anything, for everything, for free. Security is always top down. If you think the senior leadership is not understanding it, it's not going to go anywhere. Why it's even harder when you're scaling up? Just one example here and I'll wind up is brute forcing. Let's say product folks, if the login has brute forcing possible, a security guy would say, hey, have a captcha in place. Now, you know, on a mobile app, you cannot have captcha. Okay. Now, how do you fix it? Now, all the standard solutions of security do not work in a product-based companies. Is something or one of the biggest problem when you're scaling up. Then you have Play Store sign-in keys available in your Git. I, as an employee, move out. I upload my APK, and what happens there? I'll just sign off on race condition is something. So I'll put up these slides later, and you guys can take a look at it. There are a couple of do's and do not tips that I covered, which is a way to comprehensive list that I had in place. And I wanted to cover all of this, which was important. Just one proposal that I'm proposing is with all the payment companies is I'll say we need to have a negative database sharing where somehow people could say, hey, this is bad data and all others could consume in certain fashion is what I'm proposing. I'm saying you need to have a scoring for all your customers. Preparedness for breach is something I'm proposing, and you need to manage all your frauds. Apart from that, a disclaimer is this. There is nothing specific to Ola, and I haven't touched upon these things. It was general 101 session for security to give you guys a flavor of what security is and why you should care about it. Just a flavor of it. For questions, I'll be available around. You guys can catch up and discuss with me. Sorry for taking more time than expected.